As the host of this year's BRICS summit, held in Xiamen on the Sea in Fujian province, China anticipates working with other member countries, Brazil, Russia, India, South Africa, to assess the decade-long BRICS cooperation project and to draw up a blueprint for future development. The BRICS summit theme, Stronger Partnership for a Brighter Future. Obviously, China has the largest economy of the five. In fact, China's economy is more than 60% larger than the other four economies combined. So why is BRICS important to China? Does China's disproportionate power mean that China dominates decision-making? How does China contribute to BRICS, for example, to the New Development Bank, the financial institution under BRICS? How do BRICS countries view the organization's continuing or changing roles? More pointedly, how do BRICS countries manage their internal tensions? Moreover, why aren't other large developing countries included? Indonesia, Mexico, Turkey, Pakistan? BRICS is indeed important to China. That's why BRICS is important to closer to China. The first co-production motion picture by directors from five BRICS countries, Where Has Time Gone? Five short stories that depict, from different perspectives, how human sentiments can mellow with time.
We have been searching for a common theme that could touch the audience of every nation of BRICS, something that would resonate. That's how we came up with the idea of Where Has Time Gone?
The goal of the film is to explore a universal theme of understanding, especially as shared by people living in burgeoning and fast-changing BRICS countries. The film hopes to go beyond filmmaking, bonding the five nations.
I think the movie could help the BRICS countries to further strengthen and develop their cooperation not only in terms of filmmaking, but also in other fields, including culture, science, and economy. After all, we're all members of the same world.
A co-production film is one example of how the five BRICS countries can strengthen communications and deepen mutual understanding. This year marks the beginning of the second decade of BRICS. Economic cooperation continues to be prioritized, but a wide-ranging multi-tiered partnership has also been established. China, as the chair of this year's summit, works with the other member states for an enhanced BRICS partnership. The BRICS summit in Xiamen seeks progress in four areas. 1, deepen BRICS cooperation for common development. 2, enhance global governance to meet joint challenges. 3, carry out people-to-people exchanges, and 4, make institutional improvements. I speak with several thought leaders from BRICS countries. Jayan Prasad is Director General of the Indian Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis, and he's a former Indian ambassador to the UN Geneva and the EU. Shen Yi is Director of the Center for BRICS Studies at Fudan University, and Gregory Tolaraya is executive director of the Russian National Committee on BRICS Research and is a former Russian ambassador to South Korea and the DPRK, North Korea. Professor Carvalho, preparing for this year's summit in BRICS, what are the primary issues?
For the BRICS summit, I think the primary issue is connectivity. I think this is one of the most important issues.
What does that connectivity consist of? Are we talking about physical connectivity of roads and shipping and aircraft or information flows? What are the kinds of connectivity that's meaningful? It's not just a kind of a floating word.
It's a good question, because when we think about connectivity, first we think about transportation, energy, science and technology, trade, investments. And this is an important part of a project of integration, you know, an economic integration in a certain way. But there is another kind of connectivity very important to the BRICS project, especially to the future, the people-to-people connectivity. Why? Because there are a lot of misunderstandings about, you know, the BRICS group, the BRICS countries. There are a lot of differences, the geographical distance as well, all of this bring a lot of challenges to the countries, and that's why I think the governments have to think about how to improve the people-to-people connectivity.
How do you analyze China's participation in BRICS?
I see China very active, and I think China always likes to see itself as a developing country, so they have no prejudice against that at all. I think, on the contrary, I think there will be one day in which China will no longer be a developing country, maybe, but still see it itself that way because of the attitude. It's not only the question of the GDP per capita, it's also the attitude accepting principles like the one of non-intervention.
So we insist we are new. We are a new great powers with different cultural background, with new knowledges, and we want to become a new type of great powers in the world.
Within the BRICS, the economic relationships between China and other countries are asymmetric. And the concern is that over time, if you dig among other countries, that China is creating a quasi-a new colonialism that's not doesn't need armies or weapons, but it has this economic dependency of the master and the servant.
It's a challenge. It's a concern. That challenge and concern need to be treated very carefully. First, the economic has its own nature, has its own laws. Yeah. We need to respect that laws. Yeah. Second, we need to balance it. We need to control it, just like China developed its own market economies inside our countries. We need to balance two things. The first is efficiency. The second is equality. The same to dealing with this relationship with other countries. You need to notice that not only in the state, but also when China raised the ideas of this one road, one belt, China always say that we first will investment or doing trade with these countries. And the second, our top leaders already mentioned lots of times, maybe every time talking about these economic things, we need to build a linkage between the development of China on these economic issues with these local countries. We need to respect these relatively equities on these economic interests. And we need to ensure that we can build a so-called the win-win games. These win-win games means China will make a self-restraint in lots of cases.
Even though China's economy is more than all the four put together.
We have these advantages. We did not use these advantages to coerce the other countries.
Do you think that's sustainable?
I think we can keep a moderate observation on this process and the trend. Till now, it's continual and affordable. It's sustainable.
Is there a concern that that BRICS will become a mechanism to facilitate China's economic domination?
No, actually, BRICS has absolutely got nothing to do with it because BRICS does not have preferential trade arrangements amongst its members. BRICS also is not considering for now a free trade arrangement amongst its members because it is then that the economic imbalances begin to tell. And you could conceive of it in the future, but not just now. And each of the countries that constitute BRICS, like China, have a civilizational view of themselves. Take India, for example. Take South Africa's role in Africa, for example. Brazil's role in Latin America, for example. And Russia as a great bridge between Europe and Asia. So each one of them has a self-image which is not dissimilar from the self-image that Chinese have of themselves. And therefore, in that sense, although there is economic inequality in terms of how they live and each other, there is a sense of equality. And I don't think China being ahead economically is going to matter so far as BRICS cooperation is concerned.
In Brazil, strong economic growth once helped to improve living conditions for the poor and to burnish Brazil's image as a rising star among emerging economies. But over the last few years, a perfect storm of political crises, corruption scandals, and economic recession dramatically changed perceptions here and abroad. Brazil is not alone. Since 2013, other BRICS countries have also faced structural problems, including growing income gaps, lack of financial transparency, infrastructure deficiencies, etc. At the same time, the external economic environment has not been favorable for emerging economies. Representing 3 billion people and a combined GDP of $16 trillion, BRICS is seemingly the third giant after the EU and the US. But are its member nations too different and have too few synergies? Many doubt that BRICS can represent solid and sustaining economic and political power. Do these kind of internal turmoils within each country affect the kinds of conversations within BRICS?
So far, not. But in any regional or plurilateral arrangement or bilateral conversation, I think the vicissitudes of internal political change tells on foreign policy eventually. But so far, in the type of cooperation that BRICS has been able to forge, it is a kind of common understanding that the BRICS countries have developed on a range of regional and global issues. That's one contribution.
Let's ask about the areas of disagreement or even conflict among the BRICS, maybe in closed quarters.
Lots of difference, long list. People even concern or doubt whether BRICS can exist because there are so many different cultural, historical languages. In BRICS, we have so many different languages. So when we have the conference, we can speak in English. That's quite ironic things. But I think that the point is not how long the list is. The key point is to which extent the member state of the BRICS believe that we can coexist with this difference. I think that's one of the most important difference comparing to the traditional organizations. We respect the existence of this difference first. And the second, we try to solve it in a pragmatic way. It means both sides, or maybe all sides, make compromise. We build consensus. And the basement, the third, why we can get this consensus or this compromise is we have a joint understanding. The existence and the health development of the BRICS will bring benefits for all member states.
India, Brazil, South Africa are democratic in terms of their political system, and China and Russia are different from that. Does that cause any internal consternation?
It's interesting that you ask it, because in societal makeup and the internal constituents, and the composition of each of the countries, and the manner in which they are governed, they are all very different from each other. But because the principle of sovereign equality has another aspect of it, and this is another principle very dear to developing countries and dear to the BRICS countries, which is non-questioning and non-interference in the domestic affairs of each other.
You've been witnessing BRICS for the last decade almost, as it's been developing. What are some of the internal tensions that you see that you can talk about, you know, semi-publicly?
I wouldn't say tension, because we always solve that in a very friendly way. Maybe they have different positions, for instance, in relation, not totally different, but slightly different positions in relation to environment and climate change to some extent. That's why we created a different group, BASIC, without Russia. Without Russia, but that has to do with the history of the agreements on environment, the Kyoto Protocol and so on, in which Russia was classified in a different group of countries, so it has obligations that the other countries don't have. So, but it's a very technical thing.
You know that BRICS is a very loose organization. It's not a NATO-like, you know, alliance which is dictated in a military way from top to bottom. We pretend and we presume that our interests might be different, and it's naturally so. When you have one country which is exporter of raw materials and another country which is importer of raw materials, you know, the interests, they collide. They cannot be the same. And this is just was the presumption. BRICS was trying to create its modus operandi that this is the case, that BRICS is not the place to find solutions to these contradictions, but rather find the areas and issues where we can cooperate. And there are lots of them. But when we need to act differently, we do act differently. That presume that we should try to do everything together. So there are, of course, some contradictions between different countries. And the Indo-Chinese relations these days, they worry me a lot. Although, from my own experience, I know, and this is very important, when Chinese and Indians meet in one place and we discuss issues of cooperation, we become very, you know, pragmatic, friendly, and cooperative. We don't speak about rhetorical issues or other things. We are speaking about concrete issues, and I think this is also an important mechanism to bring the representative countries, their leaders together, and to do some joint things regardless of their contradictions in other areas. There are also, well, general issues like non-proliferation, you know, which is not very pleasant to India, for example, which we also will abstain from too much, you know, pressing each other. But it is, this structure is built in BRICS. We're not trying to find unanimity in everything. We're trying to find the areas where we're unanimous.
The African Regional Center of BRICS New Development Bank, a full-service office in Johannesburg, officially opened its doors in August 2017. But it's not there simply to benefit South Africa.
The New Development Bank was created by the five large emerging economies, which are also developing countries. And according to the article of agreement on the bank, when the time is ripe, it will be open to other developing countries along with the UN member states. We predict that the New Development Bank will take in new members, including African countries, in the foreseeable future. By that time, this center will be a real regional one, with services goes beyond borders of South Africa.
Committed to open and inclusive development, in addition to the financial institution, BRICS is also exploring other models and mechanisms.
We're working for BRICS Plus, which could form a wide-range cooperation mechanism, gathering emerging markets and developing countries.
BRICS Plus means any country, region, or entity that seeks cooperation will be welcome. By holding dialogues with other developing countries and major organizations, BRICS can build wider partnerships and become an influential platform for South-South cooperation. To optimize BRICS, what is its structure? What should it be in the future?
The strength of BRICS is that it does not have a charter, and it does not have an organization, and it doesn't have, as you said, a secretary general, because there is a worrisome trend in BRICS from my perspective, and that is that from the first declaration to the Goa declaration, it has grown from a dozen paragraphs to 120 paragraphs in Goa. And the longer the declaration, the less effective it might become.
So that terrifies.
In terms of that terrifies me. What terrifies me more, if you had a secretariat, then they will produce more paper and less tangible results.
How do you see the future for BRICS? Do you see it needing to move to an organization, or would that make it worse?
No, I don't think we should be worried with that. I think we should be more concerned with concrete steps. I think the bank is a very important step. It has now already approved the first loans, and all of them very much linked to sustainable development in the countries. It has not disbursed money yet, but anyway, so it's moving. So I think this is the kind of thing that will make the group more cohesive, rather than, let us say, creating a big institutional architecture. I don't exclude that this may happen, but as we move on, it may be, one may feel, well, now it's time to create a secretariat and to put the whole thing together to avoid repetitions. Yeah. No, that may happen. I don't exclude, and I think actually it should happen.
I think there are three scenarios of BRICS development, institutional development. One is BRICS just degrading to a sort of fourth opportunity, to the periodical meetings of leaders, well, discussing things, but not doing much in practical areas. And now this BRICS becoming a structured organization with the decisions which are obligatory, which should be implemented, and with lots of, you know, bureaucracy, if not exactly a bloc, if not because BRICS, of course, will never become a political or military bloc, but some kind of rigid organization. And the third way is in between. BRICS being more cooperative in one areas and less structured in other areas, but the overall coordination should have some level which would enable first to prepare and take decisions together and implement them and check the implementation.
The Belt and Road Initiative in China is a huge thing. It involves much of the developing world. It seems to overshadow BRICS.
Belt and Road is an initiative that, well, concerns very concrete things that unites the Chinese investment infrastructure and trade economic projects in the Eurasian area mostly, as well as some of the sea lanes. So it is not directly related to BRICS. It's one of the aspects of cooperation between the countries which happen to be in BRICS, but it's not the basis for BRICS. And as I've said, BRICS is a union of reformers. We're about not so much to cooperate with each other, but to join our power to reform the world order.
I think there are two things, maybe in the different levels. They overlap in some function or detailed country case. But generally speaking, the BRICS things is on the global levels. It's global governance issues focusing on the improvement of the global governance systems in general. That one route, one belt thing. Program, just you mentioned, is a very detailed case-by-case, program-by-program. I think they have some overlappings, but not to say that one will undermine the others. They can coexistence, and they have different functions in the ground strategic framework of China's diplomacy.
What complaints or frustrations does South Africa have within BRICS?
I definitely think on the trade side, they would like to see a much more kind of expedited set of trade arrangements.
What's an example of a trade arrangement?
For example, in order to move and push ahead on market access, there's talk about having perhaps a kind of intra trade agreement between the BRICS to facilitate both market access and to deal with tariffs and non-tariff issues. I think the other frustrations is the fact that whilst they are a collective and whilst there's no underlying trade agreement that governs their economic activity with each other, they still apply the WTO rules. That could be a frustration for perhaps particular constituencies in South Africa, especially in the agricultural sector or in the non-agricultural sector in terms of non-agricultural market access.
Does BRICS have an opportunity to improve the world?
Yes, I think this is one of the key issues for BRICS activities. First of all, we are now trying to address the new challenges and threats, and especially things like terrorism, you know, international crime, cybersecurity for this matter, and others which we feel that our efforts are needed, and we need intra-BRICS cooperation to tackle this matter, not just going through the international organizations, which of course deal with the same problems, and of course we are dealing in the same kind of rules and in kind of manner that is universally accepted, but nevertheless we have these issues we can effectively agree together. We have the special channels for that kind of cooperation, meetings and, well, exchange information. This is one thing. Another thing, security, we speak about security in more general sense of word, as security in international affairs and crisis prevention. This is something also which BRICS taking more and more interest in. And if you look through the declarations of BRICS summit, you can see that the more and more attention there is paid to the regional conflicts and hotspots in different places, not necessarily geographically related to BRICS. And this is something new when the five big countries were speaking one voice.
If we look to the future, from China's perspective, what would an ideal BRICS look like 10 or 15 years from today?
I think after 10 or 15 years, we wish that the BRICS can be more concrete, more institutionalized, and have more matured in these decision these mechanisms, so that they can providing more public goods the world required and benefit as much as country as possible. And this BRICS can become a platform, allow these newly emergent great powers have their voice and positive input more smoothly with already existed so-called the traditional structures.
The rise of non-Western economies, exemplified by BRICS, is a tectonic shift in the long-standing world financial order. While BRICS countries, especially China, have benefited greatly from the existing global governing system, they are no longer content to play passively according to rules set by others. BRICS countries understandably demand reforms, proposing that current bodies of international finance be adjusted and new bodies be created. BRICS countries, however, have different ideas on how the institution should operate, whether more informally as a loose association, or formally with a secretariat and sub-institutions. As host of the 2017 summit, China envisions BRICS as a platform for economic global governance, and it hopes that these meetings among heads of state can catalyze a strategic agenda for its future development. But BRICS has systemic problems, especially vast economic and political differences among member states. Personally, looking long into the 21st century, I'm watching China-India geopolitics. The future of BRICS is an open question, worth following to keep closer to China.